Good evening, councillors. Good evening, everybody. Please be seated. Good evening, everybody. I've been notified of the following apologies. Councillor Jim Crabtree, Councillor Leah Fraser, Councillor Andrew Hodgson, and Councillor Pat Williams. I think Council would like to send their regards to Councillor Pat Williams, as I know that she's been in hospital having an operation. We can pass those remarks on, please. Thank you. And Councillor Rob Bexon. And Councillor John Hay. Thank you for those statements. Item two, the declarations of interest. The first item of business is the declarations of interest. Councillors, you are asked to consider whether you have any disclosable pecuniary or any other relevant interest in connection with any matters to be determined at this meeting, and if so, to declare it and state the nature of such interest. May I remind you that you should state the item number and title and the nature of the interest in question. Is there any declarations of interest?
Mr. Mayor, I have an interest in the education culture given by the National Wife's
Committee. Any other declarations of interest? Thank you, councillors. Moving on to item three, MERS announcements. I've only got one, and that is this is a budget council meeting. I understand passions will be running high tonight, but you must be respectful. I will expect respectful debate. I will not tolerate personal attacks or personal comments, and I'm willing to eject if I need to. Those announcements over. Moving on to item four, approval of the minutes. Item four on page 1-26 of the agenda contains the minutes of the council's meeting held on the 14th of December 2015. I will move approval of the minutes as a correct. Do I have a second? Are there any issues or inaccuracies in respect of the minutes? No. All in favour, please clearly indicate. Votes against? Abstentions? Moving on to item five, petitions. I have been notified that Mr. David Haley will hand in a petition from the carers against the arrangements for the proposed closure of Girtrell Court. I have agreed to this request. Mr. Haley, please hand in your petition to the office.
The other petition was a paid petition run on Saturday last week. Over 600 signatures on that petition. Both petitions beg this council to keep Girtrell Court running until proper alternatives are established, costed, evaluated, consulted upon, and proven to be adequate.
Thank you.
Close by Park
be on the agenda as a fine. Now, item 4B, a petition in respect of will change has been received with more than 3,000 signatures. This petition has now been withdrawn and will therefore not be debated tonight. A further petition has been received, submitted by Will Unison, with 3,054 signatures in respect of proposed closure of Girtrell Court. In accordance with the Council's petition scheme, the lead petitioner has been invited to speak to his petition for up to 5 minutes. Please do so, sir.
I address you tonight on behalf of the service users and all members of Girtrell Court. A facility looks after the most vulnerable in our society with dedicated and committed excellent staff. Wirral, along with the local authorities, does face some extremely challenging times. Have received this Conservative government hell-bent on shrinking the state and reducing the public sector provision. We have not been afforded the handout from the £300 million transitional fund. The loss of the revenue support grant and proposed change to business rates make for some difficult times and choices in the coming years. The 6,300 plus members we have certainly showed the board in their first year as well, with real-time cost of living cuts to their wages of 15% since 2010. But this is a Labour-led authority that has, in its 2020 pledges, committed to look after the most vulnerable in our society. Closing this facility will not and does not protect elements of that group. It makes a mockery of that pledge. We have had some meaningful consultations these last few months. It has been tough and sometimes heated. We have found resolutions in some areas, but the proposal to close Girtrell Court simply does not stack up. Unison cannot understand why a Labour-led administration would accept and implement the office proposal. Society should be judged by its treatment of the weakest and most vulnerable. We have talked of the authority being open and transparent, yet the Cabinet Member for Adult Care and Public Health, alongside the Director for Adult Social Services, will ultimately make the decision on Girtrell Court. It will not be made in the public domain. Unison does not believe that a robust and sustainable alternative is available to meet the specialist needs of the service users. The leader has stated it is all about choice. There is no choice out there. He and Councillor Chris Jones have maintained that the provision will be as good, if not better, than have been provided now. We ask, as we have continually asked, for proof of this. Can you as elected members evidence that all users have that option? If you can't, you simply can't close this facility. Comprehensive research has been undertaken by some of the carers and families, and it is clear the provision is not available to the level they receive now, if at all. The impact this is having on them, and will have on them going forward, is heartbreaking. One of the first Unison meetings we held, a carer asked that those making the decision are 24 hours in my footsteps. Believe me, they do a fantastic job, and they rely on the dedication and staff at Girtrell Court. Unison believes that there are significant holes in the financial calculations and assumptions. The department has acknowledged that over 300,000 in corporate recharges will be a saving to the department, but not to the council. Also missing from the figures is 5 people currently living there after their previous placements failed. The cost of alternative provision is up to £100,000 per person per year. Those 2 figures alone are greater than any saving proposed by the department, and that will not go into detail on the figures. This is the last in-house adult social care service, and once it has gone, it will be gone forever. You simply cannot allow the expertise and dedication of the 40 plus staff that face compulsory redundancies under the Labour administration walk out of the door without actual proof that a saving can be achieved. Assessments for users have only taken place since the option was muted. Some have not been assessed for over 10 years. How can you quantify a saving when you do not know what provision people will need and what cost that will bring? You, as elected members, are accountable to the people of Wirral. People of Wirral will come out in support of this campaign to prevent the closure of this facility. We have lodged a petition of over 3,000 signatures from users, staff, the general public, who I might add are quite shocked at this proposal being considered. That you understand the feeling that is out there for this facility. Yes, the Conservatives have closed 5 facilities on their watch, but 2 wrongs don't make a right. We do not want this debate to be a political point scoring exercise. We do not want a table tennis debate. mudslinging from one side to the other. We want this facility to remain open. When the proposal to close the respite care homes was put before council in 2011, Councillor Fowkes proposed an amendment to a substantive motion. It was seconded by our current leader, Phil Davis. It read, the council stop immediately the closure of all council-run respite care homes, at least until a satisfactory alternative has been found and approved by the majority of the current users and their carers. We want the care of the most vulnerable in our borough to be one of our council's highest priorities, and we do not want any cuts to the overall level of support provided to those vulnerable members of our community and their carers. Can we ask for a guarantee that this facility remains open until evidence that as good as, if not better, is available? Because for us, that will be a victory, as we do not believe that provision is there. We have seen only last month the Care Quality Commission inspection into Medicroft, and although I'm not saying any of the facilities that the service users of Girtrell Court will find themselves in would have these problems, it clearly shows the anxiety they face when the provision is not made directly from the local authority. The savings proposals are optimistic. Another line we've continually used has been evidenced by using more than £9 million of reserve to balance our books this year. At a time when users, their families, the public and staff see press stories of the frivolous use of taxpayers' money, we implore you to look in the mirror, look into the eyes of those people in the balcony upstairs and tell them hand on heart there's a better provision out there. We know you can't do that, and as such for years you just fully drop this motion. Thank you for your time.
Savings. However, I believe the scale of what we're facing over the next 5 years means that the old model of local councils delivering services directly from the town hall is no longer sustainable. We will need to totally transform the way we deliver public services through new models, working with our partners, sharing services with others, and asking residents to get more involved in the provision of local services. Those who've been around for a while may remember Nicholas Ridley, former minister in the Margaret Thatcher government in the 1980s. He used to boast, I remember him well, that his vision for local government was that councils would turn up to the town hall once a year, merely to award contracts for services. And Mr. Mayor, I fear this vision is fast becoming a reality. We know that for the past 6 years, the government has pursued a blatantly ideological agenda of shrinking the state. They've dressed that up as tackling the deficit, but at its heart, it's been about removing public provision systematically and letting the market dictate. In the case of local government, Mr. Mayor, we know that this has entailed cuts nationally of 40% or £20 billion. In the case of Wirral, our budget has been cut over the last 5 years by over 50%, £150 million, with another £129 million of cuts over the next 5 years. Now, so when it comes to distributing local government funding, the government's also pursued what I think you can only describe as a deeply partisan policy of favouring more affluent areas with Tory councils and Tory MPs. We saw this most vividly last month when the Chancellor distributed a £300 million relief fund to overwhelmingly Tory-run areas such as Surrey, Hampshire, Hertfordshire. It also included David Cameron's council in Oxfordshire and George Osborne's council in Cheshire East. The five most deprived councils in the country got nothing. The five least deprived got £5.3 million. Residents in councils like Wirral, Mr. Mayor, will rightly be outraged that we received not one penny of this money, and the absence of any protest from the party opposite in this council, I think, speaks volumes for their unwillingness to stand up for the people of Wirral against the policies. Mr. Mayor, I believe we must continue to lobby the government to change their approach to funding local government and give Wirral a fair deal. From 2016-17, we'll have the biggest funding challenge we've ever faced. Under the guise of setting councils free, the government has announced its intention to abolish the revenue support grant, the main block of money which councils like Wirral traditionally depended on. This will be phased out completely over the next 5 years, and in our case, we will lose £65 million, with £14 million being cut next year alone. It's for this reason, the huge cut in the RSG, together with the failure of the government to provide any funding for demographic change or increased growth, that we are having to create a revenue contingency fund for 16-17. This truly is, Mr. Mayor, the cost of government incompetence. We also know that in 2016-17, not only has the government scrapped the council tax freeze grant, but it also decided that councils who want to spend more money on adult social care will have to raise council tax by 2%. This grey tax is effectively the government saying to residents of Wirral, you're on your own, don't look to government to fund additional spending on social care. If you want to do this, you, the residents, have to pay 2% additional council tax on top of the 1.99% council tax that will have to go up because the freeze grant has been scrapped. And I know that apart from a few groups which the Conservative amendment exempts, both of the opposition parties are proposing 3.99% council tax rise next year. But using the council tax to pay for vital services such as social care, I believe is deeply regressive for councils like Wirral, because we know we have a low council tax base, and we know that we're unable to raise anywhere near as much money as some more affluent councils in the south, with very expensive houses and very, very big companies where they can raise lots of money from the council tax and lots of money from the business rates. So yet again, this will, I think, yet increase the gap between affluent areas in the south and poorer areas in the north. So much, Mr. Mayor, for the much vaunted Northern powerhouse. Now, Mr. Bear, against this extremely difficult background, Labour's approach to setting the budget for next year has firstly been to ensure that we focus on delivering our 20 pledges in the Wirral plan. In 2016-17, we will still be spending over £260 million on delivering services to local residents, £70 million to support elderly and disabled residents, £70 million on protecting children and young people, £50 million on keeping our environment clean and attractive. We've also listened to the feedback from the first Wirral residents survey for some time, and we'll be spending £10.5 million on road and highways repairs across the world. £2 million on refurbishing our leisure centres, and £2 million on tackling the antisocial behaviour, including extending the successful campaign on fining people for littering to a real crackdown on dog fouling, which I believe will be welcomed across the country. Mr. Mayor, in these times of austerity, working in partnership with other agencies in the public and private sector has never been so important. And I'm proud that this council is part of a fantastic public-private partnership which is investing £6 million in a new Wirral youth zone, a facility which will provide world-class sport and recreation facilities for our young people. The building is underway as we speak, will be completed by the end of this year and open in January 2017. This will further help us reduce antisocial behaviour, as well as improving the health, confidence and self-esteem of our young people, and is an excellent example of a progressive council making a real difference to people's lives. We have ambitious plans also, Mr. Mayor, for regenerating Burton Head, which will bring in £150 million in private sector investment. And if you add projects which are in the pipeline for both Wirral Waters, further development of plans for an international golf resort in Hoylake, then 2016 promises to be an exciting year for growing our local economy and creating more jobs. I'm also delighted that in 2015-16 we'll achieve a balanced budget, which means that we will be able to protect our vital frontline services. What a contrast, Mr. Mayor, from the £17 million overspend we inherited from the previous administration in 2012. And may I take this opportunity, Mr. Mayor, to thank all our staff for the excellent job they do, day in, day out, in delivering services for the residents of Wirral. Now, with regard to the £28 million savings we've had to find next year, our approach has been to achieve as much of this as possible from bringing in additional funding to the council. We know that every pound of additional income we generate is a pound less we have to find in cuts. I'm therefore pleased that the £28 million savings which we have to deliver next year, £18 million of that is being achieved through extra income from items such as council tax, new homes bonus, from building new houses, and our successful negotiations with joint boards has resulted in a reduction in the cost of the levies from emerging travel and the waste authority. £2.1 million of the £28 million will be found by managing demand, and a further £2.2 million will come from delivering services differently. This includes new models, ranging from transferring one of our recreation centres in Beechwood to the community to run, providing leisure facilities in a more business-like way, and reviewing our policy on concessions. In the past year, we set up two local authority trading companies, Essentials and Rural Evolutions, both of which are able now to attract new funding streams. Over next year, we will look at new models for other services as part of an ambitious transformation programme. Finally, the £28 million savings target. Of that £28 million, I'm pleased we are only having to find a small proportion, some £2.2 million, from service changes. Mr. Mayor, we are a listening administration. We've listened to feedback from the 10,000 people who responded to the budget consultation and the views of elected members of the three scrutiny committees which looked at the budget options, and I'd like to thank all of those people for taking part. As a result of this, we decided to withdraw the following savings. Firstly, we won't be proceeding with the closure of the in-house welfare rights unit. We recognise, Mr. Mayor, that at the time when the government is recklessly cutting welfare benefits, it's essential that our residents have access to good quality advice. We know that the council provides substantial amounts of funding to external organisations to deliver welfare rights. And during the year, I want us to do a review of all of this funding to ensure we're getting value for money. Secondly, we won't be proceeding with the savings options around libraries. We need to undertake, I believe, a fresh review of library provision to ensure we can continue to deliver quality service, but hopefully at a more acceptable cost. I want to build on the excellent model which Councillor Mike Sullivan has established in Penton Primary, and I would like to pay tribute to Mike for the enormous effort which he personally has put into making that success. Thirdly, in line with our principles around protecting vulnerable communities and reducing inequalities, I'm pleased to announce that we intend to retain free swimming in school holidays for those young people who are most economically disadvantaged in the borough, as defined by the pupil premium. Finally, I'm able to report that following a lengthy period of negotiations with our trade union colleagues, we've reached agreement that our workforce would continue to take 4 days unpaid leave for a further 5-year period. In contrast to the Conservative budget, we intend to protect our lowest paid staff by retaining pay enhancements, and we will also help key staff such as social workers by retaining essential car user allowances for the immediate future. Now, Mr. Mayor, we've also had to take some difficult decisions for the budget next year. The most challenging has undoubtedly been the issue around Girtrell Court, and I'll just say a few words about that. Can I say first of all that I am genuinely sympathetic and sorry for any upset that has been caused to our service users and their families. I do understand that people who use the service have great affinity to both the staff and that building. However, it's important to understand our approach to this issue. The key point to make is that this is not simply a budgetary issue. At its heart, it's about giving people with disabilities more choice.
No. That's rubbish! Absolute rubbish!
Grass bag the gate or not the books.
I absolutely agree. I absolutely accept that many people will continue to want a traditional and accessible residential care facility, the kind that's provided at Girtrell Court. However, we know that many people want alternative options.
Give us figures, please.
For example, supported living, where people have their own tenancy supported by staff. Shared lives, where people stay with a paid care. Some people want support at home through an agency via the use of direct payments. And some want activity-based holidays. The issue with Girtrell Court is that all of our budget for respite care is tied up in that one building, which means that we cannot offer people alternatives. We know that people want the ability to choose the type of care and support which is right for them. At present, they are unable to do this. This is not about the building or the provider, it's about the person. As Council will know, we're currently undertaking a statutory consultation with service users and their families, which will be completed later this month.
Yeah.
The Director then tends to go out to carers early in April with a clear new service offer and to arrange events for carers and care for people to meet potential new providers. He will commission services for all of the identified needs at that stage. Authority will be delegated to the Director in conjunction with the Cabinet Member to make decisions in order to avoid any undue delays. We're not imposing any deadlines on when this process will be complete, and in the meantime, Girtrell Court will remain open. In conclusion, no one who currently receives respite care will stop getting it. But can I emphasise that this change, which I appreciate is difficult, is being done to increase choice. And I'm confident at the end of this process, we will be able to offer alternatives which are equal or better than existing provision. And finally, Mr. Mayor, all of these arguments are precisely the ones used by the party opposite to justify the closure of 5 residential homes which they moved in 2010. So I look forward to hearing why they changed their views when Councillor Green moves his amendment. So in closing, Mr. Mayor, this has been a very difficult budget to set. However, I believe that unlike the opposition amendments, this administration's budget is sustainable. It does not leave huge holes in the budget in future years. It focuses on spending we will make to deliver our pledges. It acknowledges the work that we need to do in partnership. It puts provision in place to deliver an ambitious transformation programme. Our budget tackles some of the difficult issues that I've mentioned, and we have listened to the views of residents. It's pragmatic, but it's also, I believe, grounded in Labour values of social justice. Finally, I'd like to thank my colleagues in the Labour Group for their hard work throughout the year in putting this budget together. I also want to acknowledge the excellent advice we've received from officers. I so move.
I'm now recommending that the proposal is that the change is introduced from the recommendations laid out in the report are on pages 193 to 194. I read them out, go through them very, very quickly. Cabinet recommends the school's budget £243,273,400. The Budget Council, having taken account of views and changes proposed by the school's board. And that these are that the contributions to combined budgets should be £1,698,800. And to the use of dedicated schools grant reserves, £1,568,900 to set schools budget. And the school's funding formula is submitted to the Education Funding Agency and is made up, is unchanged from decisions made in previous years. And that the permanent changes to high needs places are agreed together with the allocation of high needs growth of £532,000. And the necessary steps are taken to trade or cease services where direct central funding is withdrawn at the end of the summer term for minority ethnic support, city learning centres and wellbeing. And following consultation and discussion with schools and the schools forum, the school's redundancy policy is charged with effect from, is changed from effect from September 2016. Future, as I said earlier, the only cost of moving to the 4th century will be where staffing decisions are taken as well as performing school roles. All other redundancy costs are certainly must be charged to the delegated schools budget concern. So those were the recommendations. Can I just say very, very briefly, it's been a very, very difficult financial year for our schools and extremely challenging times. But once again, I'd like to praise the work that's been done in our nursery schools, in our primary and secondary schools. And I'd just like very, very quickly to bring to the attention of the full council about the continuous improvement in all.
Gentlemen, you just wind up.
Oh, okay, so we have excellent results in GCSEs. We increased our rate again, also early years and nurseries and so on. So it's been an excellent year in schools. So I'd like to thank all the staff for what they've done. Thank
secrecy and delegation brings me on to the post of the council leaders executive.
it's not fair. Mr. Mayor, as far as I can see, the role has added no value to the people of Wirral, and therefore we should say very openly that it should go and return the £56,000 it's costing, more if we add the rather push off new offices created with next order, to the council taxpayers of Wirral. And while on the subject of returning taxpayers' money, if this amendment is agreed tonight, it will also see pensioners on fixed incomes who work hard all their lives, play by the rules and pay their taxes, protected from the whittling away of the income they need to enjoy their retirement by protecting them from the Labour Administration's 3.99% council tax increase. And in addition, Mr. Weller, as we believe the evidence of improved outcomes for children who have been removed from difficult situations and placed in foster care, healthy living, improved life chances, improved educational achievement, and perhaps the greatest outcome of all, being kept safe, we believe vulnerable children in Wirral need more potential, suitably skilled foster carers to step forward. The Conservative Group believe we should, on behalf of our community, thank Wirral residents who step up to this challenge. Therefore, our amendment to pass tonight will exempt all Wirral Council registered foster carers who have been active in the last 12 months from the Wirral element of Labour's council tax increase. And in fact, Mr. Mayor, it's interesting to note that the implementation of this plan to thank Wirral foster carers, the amazing work they do with some of Wirral's most damaged children, will cost less than Labour Council leader's executive support officer, aka Chief of Staff. And while on the subject of choices, Mr. Mayor, it appears that while happy to close services such as Girtrell Court and remove lollipop ladies, it appears the Labour Party have tried to squirrel away considerable sums of council taxpayers' money in reserves. In fact, Mr. Mayor, from the £108 million the council has in the bank, the budget proposed by the Labour administration will see £11.5 million in general fund balances, £9 million in a transformation reserve, and yet a further £11.2